not forgive me with such disdain? What do you think? This is some kind of a pity party? Yeah. Well, let me tell you something. It's not. And let me tell you something else, too. When somebody calls and starts the phone call, don't get upset, but hang on. Because nothing good ever comes after that. You see, I should know. Because my call started like that. Don't get upset. But Dad has stage 4 pancreatic cancer. I mean, seriously, what? Now, what the hell do you do with that? I mean, part of me wanted to get all professional. Thank you for calling. Have a nice day. And then I thought maybe I could just hang up, like the call never happened at all. You know, maybe it was some grand telemarketing scheme, some asshole in Nigeria. He calls up unsuspecting people and tells them their dad's dying of pancreatic cancer. Oh, but he can cure it if you send him $10,000 in a Cheerios box by FedEx. Shit. But it wasn't a scam. It was real. And it damn near killed me. I mean, I almost died right there on the spot. But I didn't. You know, instead I think I asked how my mom was. I mean, what a bullshit, stupid thing to ask, right? Is she okay? No, nobody was okay. We were just trying to figure out how to breathe. But here's the thing. She kind of was. I mean, she was like a rock, like a mighty oak. I mean, that woman did not lose her shit for 10 more months. She was some kind of superhero. And I will never know how she did that. And so it began at that moment. My cancer story. It's like your personal equator. Like everything in your life, either been before or after that moment. We were gonna lose him. That was pretty clear right from the very beginning. I mean, we're all gonna die, right? We are. But Dad, skinny Dad with his bony elbows, if he didn't shove right to the front of that line. A mere 7% of patients live longer than a year. Huh. What a clinical description of the living hell that awaited us. And what do you do when people ask if you're okay? Yeah, I'm okay, except for the cancer thing and this shoe that's too tight. And how about when people bitch and complain? Because people bitch and complain. I got every red line on the way to work. Yeah, well, my dad's dying of cancer, so piss off. That shit shuts me down fast. Oh, God, I think I need some help.
I lost someone, something. I became someone who measures life by losses. But guys, I got something too, and I know that sounds crazy. And I get a lot of strange looks when I say that, but it's true. But cancer doesn't really give anything, it just takes, right? It just takes. Well, you know, I used to think that, and I was wrong. You never forget the moment when cancer starts. And let me tell you, the human brain is like that. I mean, you can walk up to your refrigerator and stare at your shit for for 2 full minutes because you cannot remember why you opened the door. But the cancer thing, you never forget when that started. You never forget when it began to happen because it is always happening. It never stops happening. You remember the sound of the doctor's voice, the look on his face when he told you that Dad was going to die. Let me tell you something, I wanted to punch that guy right in the throat. I did. I didn't. I didn't know what I wanted. Oh man, but Dad did. He wanted to live. Oh, he wanted to live so bad. And let me tell you something, his chances sucked. I mean, that guy had a better chance of getting struck by lightning or space debris. And he handled it well. And I didn't. I forgot how to breathe, and I remembered how to cry. Really ugly cry. And it wasn't about self-pity, it wasn't. Because all I could think about was Dad, 45 minutes away, in his big blue armchair, dying. And Mom sitting on the couch watching carefully to make sure it hadn't happened yet. I guess cancer begins like anything else. Begins on day one. So there we are outside the oncology center. This nondescript building, just brick and mortar. I will never forget that building. It looked more like a place you'd go to get your taxes done than to get the Dad's Gonna Die speech. Totally unremarkable, and I will always hate it. So we're all standing there like we just witnessed a plane crash, and somebody, maybe me, I think I did, asked Dad, what do you want to do? Me after all, I figured, let's let him decide. And he said, I think I'd like to go to McDonald's. Okay. I mean, what could it possibly hurt? He could order everything off the menu and we would just sit there and watch him while we ate it. I mean, LDL, HDL, who gives a shit? Eat the fries, Dad. I mean, that's what I would do. I mean, that's not what I would do because, I mean, nobody did vegan and you wouldn't do that. You guys know where I'm going with that. You know what I'm talking about. And so we survived day one. And let me tell you, it was some kind of miracle. We all stood there in the street like we'd just run through a war-torn country. The holding clan, all bloodied and battered and bruised. On our first day out with Dad, the cancer died. And then comes day two, when the telling starts. When you try to act like a normal person, and go out into a normal world that looks anything but normal. And you get up and you get showered and you get dressed in something presentable. And let me tell you, it's a bitch. But you gotta do it. You gotta try to behave in a normal manner because you cannot go running, screaming through this produce section in Price Chopper. I mean, that shit freaks people out. My tight circle moved quickly, and they were amazing. They held me up. But I was a business owner. I mean, where do you draw that line? Who do you tell? How do you do this? I mean, do I tell the mailman? Business colleagues? I mean, the lady at Walmart who rings up the ho-hos? Things become really small and really, really great, and that's where the giving comes in. Because cancer gives you moments. Moments you might miss if Dad wasn't dying. And those moments change you. You become better, more. And if they don't, you should go talk to somebody. Cancer gives you clarity. It makes you sharper, and you begin to notice things. You begin to notice everything. You never forget the way Dad blew out his last birthday. It was the best cake ever. the most important cake. And you love it more too, not just because it's cake, but because it's Dad's cake. It's one of those, have your cake and eat it 2 minutes. And let me tell you something, cancer, life, doesn't give you too many of those. Cancer gives you time. Not as much as you want, but it's important time. It's time with Dad. And he's running out. Cancer lets you know that you're part of something amazing, special, the end of a legacy. And you get one last summer and one last fall and one last Thanksgiving and one last Christmas, and it rips your guts apart because you know it's the last one. But what if you didn't know? What if you didn't savor the cake and the wine and the snow and the hug and the last? I love you. You get to see something incredible. Someone leave this world. And it helps the memories of the last days to fade when every call might be the last one and you hate yourself because you hope it is. You do. You hope it's over. For Dad. You know, I'll never forget the last conversation I ever had with him. I hadn't said a thing. But he said, I heard what you said. And that was impossible. I had talked to him for 45 minutes while I drove to his bedside. He couldn't have heard me. And maybe he did. And maybe that's something too. Maybe that's some glimpse into the idea that there's something more, some new journey. And I think for him it had already begun. You know, his cancer's already. I'm not going to tell you it's not. I hate it. It is a thieving bastard. It is a taker of mothers and fathers and children and lovers and friends. But it's beautiful, and it gives you something too that you really have to look for, and that's really hard when your eyes are all battered and swollen. No, I think I still see him sometime. Tall guy with gray hair, bad baseball cap. He just slips into the next aisle in the market and then seemingly vanishes. It's a gift. It gives us just enough hope and faith to think we might see him again. And I got one more thing, too. I got to a place where I can say without crying, wasn't I lucky to have him as long as I did? And I know he's still right here, being Dad. I mean, he's probably right back there, reaching for the back of my bike. Daddy, you can let go now, because I'm okay. I got this.